Hey, everybody. We're glad you're back. Tabitha and I were talking before we started recording, and we're both mental health clinicians with full-time jobs. But today it's late at night for me and like in the evening on a Saturday. Tab just finished a training, but we're really excited about what we're going to talk about today because it's going to really marry nicely a lot of the things we've been talking about to date, but especially the treatment intervention of what we see to be really effective and helpful. So you are not going to want to miss this episode.
Welcome back, everybody, to the CPTSD podcast. I'm Tabitha Bird Weaver, licensed psychotherapist and certified drug and alcohol counselor. I'm here with my friend and colleague, Beth Pace, who is a licensed professional counselor supervisor. And just wanted to say thanks for all the support you're offering us through reviews and comments. We really, really appreciate that. And we're starting to notice some of you showing up over on our YouTube channel. So if you want to be in the in crowd, head over there and check us out, like or subscribe. And also wanted to let you know before we dig into this great meaty topic today that we have a form on the cptsdpodcast.com website where you can enter comments, questions, suggestions. So feel free to head on over there and let us know what you think. So Beth, tonight we're going to be talking about a couple of different models or modalities of therapy, eye movement, desensitization, and reprocessing, or EMDR. And as we've mentioned here before, advanced integrative therapy, or AIT. And I'm going to say, Beth, where should we start with that?
Thank you, Tabitha.
Yeah.
I am, as usual, very excited about today's topic, but that's not very different than pretty much any other time that we have met and talked. But we are going to try and keep things short today, which I like often spout off at the beginning. We're going to keep it 45 minutes or an hour, and then like an hour and 20 minutes in, we're both like, and another thing, and another. So we're going to keep it short. We're going to keep it super tight. So in brief, when Tabitha and I met, I was just beginning to work on getting AIT training, advanced integrative therapy, but I had been using EMDR with clients of mine then for about three years, and had seen a lot of movement, a lot of processing, a lot of changing. And then as I've said before, I found my way to my own therapist who is AIT trained and got my mind totally blown by how effective it was.
Yeah.
And then that's really for me when things felt like they fundamentally shifted in my healing journey. Mm. I had done EMDR for about a year and I was like making some progress, sure. But AIT lit it all up. Mm. So what we're going to do today is talk about AIT and EMDR, but we're also going to talk about the adaptive integrative processing model and how it works, especially because I have had some people say to me that their chief complaint about going to an EMDR therapist was that the process was not adequately explained to them, but that the intervention itself was like, okay, hold these buzzers, watch this light, and like everything's just going to process. But listen, if you've got CPTSD and you struggle with things like trauma-related dissociation and everything about your whole nervous system is like, don't let someone close enough, don't let this pain come up. If you're just like, I was about to let an F-bomb drop. If you're just hanging out holding some buzzers and then your therapist 30 seconds later is like, what are you noticing? You might have spent the last 30 seconds going, she's going to ask me, what am I noticing? And I have to come up with the right answer, but I can't think of anything. What is the right answer? And then she goes, what are you noticing? And you're like, nothing. Because you don't know that the juicy information is that you spent those 30 seconds obsessing about the right answer.
Right.
So, Tabitha, what is it? Day three or day four?
Day four today.
Ooh. So Tabitha Weaver just finished day four of an EMDR intensive, which sounds very energy consumptive. I took EMDR 1 and 2 over the course of 2-3 day weekends, spaced a few like weeks apart. So blessed be your journey. What do you think so far about EMDR and how it compares to AIT?
Well, that's a great question. I've known about EMDR for a long time, and I actually have used EMDR in my own healing journey with another professional coaching me. And I think that EMDR and AIT have a lot of really awesome similarities and some pretty specific areas where they're different. For example, the actual intervention technique is very different between the two. But what I really...
Same. Okay, we'll get there.
Well, I'm just saying the actual, like where the hands go, right? But on our end as therapists, it's very much the same, right? Paying attention to what's happening now, linking it into how you're feeling, what you're thinking, and then watching the changes come easily, frequently, more easily than expected, more deeply than expected. And I think one of the things I really, really, really appreciate about EMDR and AIT is this foundation of understanding that we got the core beliefs that we have, which shape our entire experience of the world while we were surviving whatever it is we survived. And so they're supportive, they're adaptive, they're important, even if they're not working for you anymore. Right? Even if they're causing distress now. And so there's an honoring of the person and how much it took to get to the place you're at today. I really appreciate that about those two. How about you, Beth? What do you compare or notice?
So I like to give people a history, especially because EMDR is a little more well-known in the clinical community than AIT is, which is something you and I are advocating fiercely to change.
Right.
To some success. But that, so Francine Shapiro, the progenitor of EMDR, eye movement desensitization and reprocessing, was just walking around in the forest one day, looking around at like things in the forest, and then noticed that as she was moving her eyes back and forth and thinking about something distressing, that the eye movement minimized the distress. Now, this might be a folk tale. It was what was described to me in my AIT or in my EMDR training, but that she was actually a graduate student at the time, but she was like getting a PhD in like literature or something. And so it's my understanding that because she was already kind of like in an educational system, she was like, I gotta go research something new. So EMDR started out with this really like deep foundation of research, researching its efficacy, you know. We don't know everything about how it works, which is always really weird for therapy, period. The brain is one of the only organs that you can't, like a psychiatrist has never seen a living brain and watched it operate the way that like a cardiologist has seen a heart. Anyway, so yep. EMDR was kind of synthesized in like the 90s and began to have like a following of people going, wow, this is really functional. This is really working. And an ever-growing body of research. Around the same time, AIT was also synthesized, but because of maybe just like different paths, different reasons that I'm not always clear on, there isn't a large body of research on AIT. What I like to say to my clients is, if EMDR is provisionally recommended by the American Psychological Association as an effective trauma treatment, it works. People are like, okay, cool. I can track that. I've heard people say that it works. AIT is like her caftan wearing, crystal bathing cousin who lives in a Winnebago and is like, I know what I'm doing works. What of it? And I love that about AIT. Yeah. Is that it isn't whether or not, like, but does the research, it's that if you try it, you experience transformational change. And that to me is significant. And that usually gets a laugh out of my clients that at the end of the day, if they're coming to me because they want to change, and I'm like, I've got something that I think is really going to help you change. Do you want to try it? So I think they're the same. I think they're the same, which is like a real hot take in both schools of thought. or in both like sort of schools of the training.
That makes sense. And I think that another thing I just want to pop in here about AIT is that I believe Asha writes on the AITI website, so Advanced Integrative Therapy Institute, that she had all this experience treating people as a psychoanalyst. And she was taking a bath one day and it just went boom in her head. And like the rest is history. And AIT and EMDR both have a lot of different therapists trained globally. And so it is likely wherever you are, who, you know, you out there needing support will be able to find either an EMDR therapist or an AIT therapist right next door to you, right? You will be able to find a resource locally. And I always appreciate that. I also, one other thing I love about EMDR and AIT is that they work on a neurological level and you can feel it while it's happening. That is so powerful because it makes us feel like we're part of the change, or maybe even the impetus of the change is coming from us instead of being done to us. Yes, if that makes sense. Yep. So Beth, I'm really interested for you to talk a little bit about the adaptive information processing and how all of that flows, because it's also, I know I see your wiggles. That's awesome. It's also really key and central to the philosophy of AIT.
Yes, mm-hmm. Absolutely. And sometimes if we fall into the habit of using like the language of it's just moving the trauma through your body and you're like, but sometimes people get lost. Mm-hmm. The adaptive integrative processing model is very much rooted in the idea of neuroscience. So yes. The idea here is that in your right temporal lobe is stored the sense, the sound, the taste, the emotion related to a traumatic memory. Okay. All of the like emotional and felt sense. So that's where quote unquote things get stuck. My EMDR trainer kind of described it like a neural pathway that's like a piece of spaghetti with red sauce all over it, glommed on there. And what EMDR is doing is like cleaning off the gunk of that neural pathway so you can just use it again. So EMDR and AIT are essentially desensitizing and reprocessing. That's the DR of EMDR. But AIT is also doing the same thing, desensitizing and reprocessing the stuck traumatic events that led to the beliefs and the worldview that are impacting someone so negatively. Here's where the juice comes in. Mm. If the right temporal lobe is where all of the trauma is stored, the trauma sense, emotions. So I can logically appreciate that I'm not a total piece of garbage, but I feel that that is real. And then we trace the thread back down to all the times and ways that someone treated you like you were a piece of garbage as a child. Okay. So again, as I said, here's the juicy part. In your left temporal lobe is all of the cognitive, processing, adult, functional, adaptive information about how to deal with life that you can't use, because in your right temporal lobe is all of this like emotion that's causing you to react. So right. With bilateral stimulation, which is either eye movement, that's the EM for DR, but it could also be like tactile bilateral stimulation. Tactile could even include like tapping your own shoulder blades. My queen, Laurel Parnell, wrote a book called Tapping In, and that is for not clinicians, but anybody. How you can use bilateral stimulation to help desensitize and reprocess some of your own neural, like nervous system activation. It's a powerful book. So what bilateral stimulation does gives us the ability to have one foot in the room, one foot back in the memory. And then what's happening is the BLS is giving enough. I read in a research article once, they called it stochastic resonance, this idea that like enough of a sort of white noise effect that your left and your right temporal lobes get to talk to each other. So the same way that like you, the 35-year-old adult knows that if you have a bad day, you can tell your partner about it and they'll go, oh yeah, this sounds like a really hard part. But remember, like, you're so good at your job and tomorrow's a new day or whatever it is. Adults know how to handle adult size problems. Kids don't.
Right.
Kids don't. So you get to use your own resources, your own brain, to heal what needs healing in your own mind. So there isn't some sort of expert in the room who's like, ooh, tell me more about your mother. It's your brain talking to your brain to go find what needs healing, clean the gunk off to release the sense memories, the deeply rooted core belief, something like I don't belong or I'm unlovable, and every other sensory experience that goes along with that memory. And it's a wonder to behold.
It really is. Especially when we as therapists get out of the way and let the client and their brain do the work. Right. Right. I really appreciate that you're talking about that BLS or bilateral stimulation, right? And what that means is that you're stimulating both sides during the same time. So right and left, right? And so you're talking about tapping or following a finger or an eye gauge. For AIT, there's still a somatic intervention. And that is really about the client touching their own body.
So it's still tactile. It's still tactile stimulation, right? Similar to BLS.
Right. And it gets you in touch with yourself in the similar way. Right. And so I think the important thing to think about is that while you're talking about the brain as left and right hemispheres in EMDR, that's still true in AIT, but the brain connects those hemispheres by stimulating each side. And what AIT does is stimulate both sides going down the center at major nerve ganglia and endocrine placements in your body. So for example, your heart, your solar plexus, or your diaphragm, right? Your pelvic floor. And we all have talked about the vagus nerve. We talked about it in episode, I think, 3 that we did, right? And that nerve runs all the way down and these huge branches of other nerves come off, and that touching those grounds us. It helps us redistribute the energy that is left around traumas. And that is the thing that people can feel moving, is the energy. And for most of my clients and myself, the energy tends to move down and out. That's not always true. But so we get, right?
It's my experience that it comes up for a lot of my folks, like things that are rooted. And then they're like, ooh, now I'm starting to feel it in my solar plexus. Or like, now I'm starting to feel it in my heart, my throat. Or sometimes for my more dissociated clients, this is where they are feeling a lot of like the blocking, their forehead and their shoulders. Think about the sort of hunching protective posture you would get into if someone was hurting you, trying to physically hurt you. You would be protecting your internal organs by like hunching in this way. And that this shoulder tension is a place where a lot of folks are holding, like, don't go any further down into my body than here.
Right. So I guess as we're talking about them simultaneously, they have a lot of similarities. And I really think that the similarities are the reason they're so much more effective than traditional talk therapy, which, by the way, I love. It just doesn't get you down the road in the same way. Right. And so, in fact, I think in EMDR, we limit the talk even more than in AIT. Is that your experience?
I will say that in EMDR 1 and 2, that is my experience. The language is very much to the spirit of like, you, the clinician, you are going to shut up and get out of the way. Aha, but wait a moment. So I already said that, like, I stan Laurel Parnell. She's a brilliant woman. I went and took an EMDR training for attachment trauma and addiction in 2019. And it changed my life. It changed my clinical practice fundamentally. We didn't even do practicums, which is to say that someone didn't do that EMDR on me and I didn't practice it on someone else. But one of the things she was saying is like, that traditional shut up and get out of the way of EMDR doesn't work for your clients who have early attachment trauma, because that left hemisphere isn't resourced with the practice of nurturance, protection, wisdom, spirituality. So when you, the clinician, are like, what are you getting? And this person's like, I have been obsessing over the last 30 seconds about how not to tell you that this sexual abuse memory is coming up because I have no idea what to do with it. So when you've got CPTSD and somebody's like, what are you getting? And you're like, nothing. And they go, well, EMDR must not be working for you. Hold up, hold up, hold up. So if you've ever had a bad experience with EMDR, and there are folks on the internet who have, they have opinions that there is a way to use tapping to imagine and light up those neural pathways to resource nurturance, protection, spirituality, and wisdom. And then you can actually use standard EMDR protocol. So it's my experience that with my my folks with CPTSD and like trauma-related dissociation or attachment rupture, if you will, standard EMDR where I'm not saying anything doesn't work. And it feels only bad and not transformative.
Thank you for saying that. I'm really glad because, as we all know, many therapists are not skilled. Right. And so my point in saying that for our listeners is please interview who you are going to be working with. It's of the utmost importance. And I think another thing that AIT and EMDR both do really nicely is they give us an ability to process implicit memory that doesn't require talking. And so just to catch people up, right? So implicit memory is the felt sense of your experience. And it's really all we have before we have speech. And so if you're somebody who's been harmed since in utero or very early in your life, you will have experiences of something bad happened, but I don't have words or even know what it is. Mm-hmm. Explicit memory is when you have an actual memory of something occurring. Now, those can get fragmented and stored in different places, like we've been talking about, mm-hmm. but that implicit memory is a real doozy for those of us who have been raised in homes where there wasn't enough nurturing, right? Go ahead.
So the idea then of like just standard EMDR is you need to go find the quote unquote touchstone, the OG memory. Okay, cute. If I'm like, yep, when I was 5, my father put a cigar out on my arm. Okay, great. We will start with that. But what about if you were being neglected and abused by those adults gestationally in utero and all the way up into 5? You're not going early enough if you start at that 5-year-old memory. And this is also where, you know, so Sandra Paulson, the fairy godmother of attachment EMDR. So like every time I love somebody, I'm like, my queen, the like vicomtesse of EMDR, stop me if it's stupid. You can put comments in the YouTube channel. That's a great reason to go watch and be like, you gotta stop that. Sandra Paulson says that if one of your clients has that sort of, her book is called When There Are No Words. And that if you don't have words for the implicit memory that Tab is talking about, how are you supposed to tell your EMDR therapist what you know needs working on? Because I'm unlovable just feels like reality. It doesn't even feel like it's associated with a trauma memory. It just feels like the facts. So what Sandra Paulson says, and I'm like pointing over to my bookcase, like it's in the bookcase. What Sandra Paulson says is if someone doesn't even have the capacity or the resource ability to get into their body, she encourages them to start with something like Reiki therapy. Oh, how interesting, Tabitha, that Reiki therapy would be recommended by an EMDR therapist as an excellent place to start. Why am I making this very sarcastic face and tone, Tab?
Well, I don't know 100%, but I'm guessing it's because Reiki is poo-pooed through our entire psychotherapy field. And yet it is actually quite empowering for a lot of people. And again, interview your practitioner.
And AIT is using language like chakras, energy right. centers. And so for me, when I read that, and even Sandra Paulson was like, you may need to start someone with something more gentle, more energy-based, and more somatic-based than EMDR. And folks, AIT fits the bill.
Sure does. It sure does. And it is something that you can use at different depths, right? So if you have a skilled practitioner, they will know not to deep dive until trust and rapport are established, until you can articulate what you're experiencing in your body. That is key, being ready to do the deep work.
And if you're not, AIT can still help you. Ah, oh, you did it. So we're like really keeping an eye on the time, because we always say we're going to keep an eye on the time, but we're like really doing it today, folks. That one of the most, so someone who is basic trained in AIT can help you with what's called the agreement or the covenant. And essentially, I think they've changed the language to be the agreement. But this idea that there are parts of you, like protector parts or your conscious mind, that is trying to protect other parts of you, thereby keeping you from being able to go do the deep dive and the trauma treatment that you want. And these beliefs are things like, it's not safe to be healed, right? If you have a lot of trauma, that would make a lot of sense. Or something like, I'll be deprived if I'm healed. What relationships might I lose if I get better? It's impossible to be healed. I don't deserve to be healed. I must be perfect is another one, right? Can't cry in a therapist's office because crying is for wussies. I must be perfect. Or I can't bear and survive all my feelings. So AIT's protocol, and EMDR has something similar. It's called blocking beliefs. And they say, right, if someone has a blocking belief, you're not going to be able to get the sort of treatment outcomes that you want, because that blocking belief, like, this is never going to help. I don't have any feelings in my body. So like, why would I need to do it? It's really, really something. And AIT is thorough in a way like nothing I've ever seen.
It absolutely is. And that list that you were just naming off about all of the potential derailments, or in AIT, we call them psychological reversals. Mm-hmm. And basically what that means is, part of you wants to heal, obviously, because you're here and engaged. And another part is like, girl, no.
Well, thank you, best friend.
Last time you healed, everybody in your life left, or you lost your job, or whatever negative consequence you're associating to the healing. AIT is very direct in the way it approaches those. And I'll tell you what, I think that can shave off years of therapy right there.
I think so. That's always been my experience too, which is that if EMDR is sometimes like touted as the fast track to trauma treatment, AIT is the gentle, thorough way to get to the roots of the trauma, wherever it is, thereby sort of pouring kerosene on this process and setting it ablaze. And Tabitha and I have both experienced AIT being done on us. So we're also not just saying like, try it. We've never experienced it, but you should try it. So this is why I have a tendency, as you may have already noticed, if you've been listening to this podcast up until this point, I get a little prickly about what I would consider to be like injustices in the world. And one of the great injustices for me was that I found myself in possession of the most incredible trauma treatment I had ever been trained in. And then watched people go, I don't know, it kind of sounds a little woo-woo to me. And I'm just like, but the science, but your brain, but the adaptive integrative, and I'm just like slamming my notebook on my lap right now, but the adaptive integrative processing, bring the unconscious material up, reprocess it and desensitize it with your left hemisphere in a safe container, which is what your therapist's office is supposed to be.
Correct. And if it's not, find a new therapist.
Speak.
And I think the bottom line is, what ends up happening for clients is that they move through problems more quickly than they anticipated and with less life interruptions. Okay, you got to show up to do the work, but it doesn't have to derail you for 2 weeks, you know, or several days after your appointment. And with AIT, I mean, I've been using AIT for at least 15 years. And so I have never, ever seen somebody who did a good AIT treatment, meaning we knew what we were doing and we took it to the end. They didn't bail. have a relapse into the symptomology. Now, sometimes other aspects come up, just like in EMDR, you're like, oh, and now I'm realizing that this is kind of connected. That does happen, but that's good because what we're doing is going in and flushing out an entire neural network around particular core beliefs. Yes. And if you don't get all of the core beliefs that unless you perform, you're not lovable out or whatever your thing is, little self-disclosure there, right? I mean, unless you get all of that out, that left brain will continue to say, you're okay. And your right brain will say, yeah, but there's this.
And that, listen, I will, it was my experience. And yeah, here's some low key personal disclosure for you guys. I left town because of Hurricane Ida in the fall, in the like late summer fall, and went up to my mother's house. I spent 9 days there. And afterwards, my therapist was like, how did that go? And I was just like, great. It went great. And I was not being inauthentic. And she was like, what? Because I spend a pretty fair amount of time in my own work talking about my mom. And she was like, what's different? And I was like, I felt for the first time that my mother was not someone I had to protect myself against anymore.
Mm. That's powerful.
So I could just see her as a human being trying her best and see her suffering through some of the same patterns that, of course, so do I. And it was like 9 days, folks. And I was like, oh, I'm really sorry this trip is ending. That for me, after 2-3 years of doing my own work in AIT, felt like a major milestone. You may be one of those folks that's like, I'm no contact with my parents and that's for me. No problem. No problem. But for me, what I noticed was that I finally, like, because my nervous system wasn't active around this person, we talked about death. We talked about Israel and whether or not I think it should be Palestine. We talked about like wild stuff as two adults.
And we're safe and available.
And it was just so touching to me.
Mm.
And that I believe is because of AIT.
Well, AIT definitely deserves credit for a lot of healing in my life too.
Yeah. Yeah.
And as we wrap up, I just want to remind people that was smooth, right? As we wrap up, I just want to remind people that while we're talking about these big changes that can happen in your life experience, you do not lose your memories.
That's right.
They just don't freak you out anymore when you think about it, right? And so the thing I worked on in training today when we did our practicum, it's bugged me for 40 years, not all the time, but when it came up, it was like, you know? And now I'm like, it'll be okay. I remember every detail.
Right.
So I just want to reassure you, you're not being brainwashed. You're not being erased, nothing like that. It is not insanity. It is pure sanity and it is pure healing.
Well, and this idea that your authentic self is what you deserve to be able to experience at some point in this lifetime, that trauma treatment is a return to wholeness.
Yes.
Becoming a completely different person that you will not understand or know anymore. And I've got a colleague who loves to say, look, treat the perfectionism and all the pain that comes with it and keep caring about doing a good job. Keep the empathy and lose the caretaking that leads you to be burned out at the end of the week because you never say no to anybody when they ask you for something. You'll still be you.
You just need to be more you.
And you deserve that.
We do deserve to be all us.
And if the only thing that got treated in your trauma treatment was like desensitizing and reprocessing the belief, I must be perfect. The other thing AIT does, which EMDR does as well, is after we clear a negative belief or a negative core belief, we install a positive cognition. And it's one of my favorites. The opposite of I must be perfect in our AIT protocol is, it's plenty good enough to be human.
Oh, yes, it is.
Hallelujah.
It's plenty good enough to be human. And with that, we will say thank you again for tuning in. please connect with us. We really are interested in what you think and feel. And we'll see you next time when we have a guest coming who will be talking with us about emotional freedom technique, another way to intervene with CPTSD symptoms.
Bye, guys. Thanks for being here.
Bye, everybody.